morning, everybody. Come on in. Welcome to the Fountain. We're going to get started with worship this morning. We're going to sing a song called I Thank God.
Another one. Well, I want to welcome you here to the Fountain Church. We're so glad that you're here for worship today. I'm Andy Lett, the pastor here, and I want to say hello to all of you who are watching us online. Today is the first week of fall break for Forsyth County, so all you who are at the beach, you're missing out today, but we miss you, and I want to welcome you. When you came in this morning, there is in your program, there is a Connect card, and I want to encourage you to take it out, fill it out. There's different ways that you can respond to the service, both on the front and on the back. And as you leave today, there's some white bins in the back, and you can place your Connect card or an offering in those white bins. For those of you joining us online, feel free to fill out a Connect card at thefountainchurch.org under Connect. But anyway, today's going to be a great service today. We're wrapping up our relationship series, and we've been talking about messy, right? Messy, and how relationships are sometimes messy. And so today, I think, is maybe the mess. I wanted to share something today in the message that really God did in my own heart. You know, some of the best things, some of the best messages that God gives you are the things that God does in your own heart and in your own life. And there was a shift that I went through in my life that I'm going to share with you a little bit today that I think is really going to help you in your relationship. So excited for that. But anyway, as we get ready for this time of worship, why don't we pray together and we'll continue doing that. God, we give you thanks and praise that God, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. That God, we can thank you. We can thank you for who you are, for what you've done. We can thank you, God, because you do heal our bones and you set us free to become the people, God, you've called us to be. And whatever darkness is around us or whatever has happened in our past, God, we thank you that you are in the freedom business. God, as we worship you today, we pray that your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, who is already among us, because as we're worshiping together here in this school, God, you are among us. We celebrate that. But God, we pray that you would speak to us, that you would show us, God, who you are, and you would help us to take our next steps in our life and in our faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Why don't we stand up as we continue this time of worship?
Yeah. My name is Mandy Lett, and I'm the Connections Director here. And I want to let you know what is coming up at the Fountain. We have a really exciting fall planned. We had a big outdoor movie night Friday night. That was awesome. And we saw a lot of families from our community that we had no prior connection with attend there. And so that was an awesome an awesome thing to see. We also have a couple more things coming up. We have this week, and then in a couple weeks, the next opportunities for the denomination affiliation information meeting. So if you attended the one at the Sugarloaf campus at the end of August, this is the exact same thing. You do not need to come again. But if you didn't get a chance to come then, I would encourage you to check out one of these opportunities this Wednesday at the Sugarloaf campus, or in 2 weeks from today here at the Johns Creek campus after worship. There are some possible changes coming in our denomination, and we want you to be informed, because any member of the church helps make those decisions about what we would do as a church if we wanted to change anything about how we're associated with our denomination. And so I encourage you to check that out and be informed, and that way you will be able to help make an informed decision about that. We also have a really fun event coming up next month called Trunk or Treat. And if you haven't done one of these before, they are a blast. Sugarloaf has done this in the past and hasn't been able to in a few years because of COVID and other things. And so they are thrilled that this is back. This is a really big community event. We're talking like 900 to 1,000 people that will be at our Sugarloaf campus, families from the community, and it'll be a really fun time. So you don't want your family to miss it. We also need some help hosting trunks. And so we'll be sharing some pictures of some ideas of things that have been done in the past, but you can sign up on your program today if you just want some more information. You'll take your car trunk, decorate it in some kind of fun, creative theme. You could get together with your refresh group, do it as a family, do it as an individual. But it will be a fun time, so make sure you mark that on your calendar and plan to be there at our Sugarloaf campus that Wednesday evening. As we continue our morning of worship, I want to remind you about the financial generosity the responsibility we have to sacrifice financially and to be part of the mission that Jesus is accomplishing in our community. There are a lot of ways you can give online. You can also give in the offering envelope that you have with your program, and there's some white bins on the way out. And so thank you for remembering to do that today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer as we continue our morning of worship. Dear Jesus, we just thank you for the opportunity, God, to worship you this morning. God, we thank you for this space made into a sanctuary on Sunday mornings, God, and we thank you for the hands that do that. And God, we pray this morning as we continue our morning of worship, God, that you would help us just to set our minds and our hearts on you. God, knowing that we all have experiences of messy relationships and ways that we can do better to love people more like you love us, God, we pray that this morning that you would speak to us, God. We pray that you would help us to just hear from you, God, and we just thank you for your presence here today. We pray for any offerings that are given today, financial gifts that are given online, and God, I thank you just for the sacrificial heart of those who give. God, we thank you knowing that you can do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine with these gifts. And so we put them before you today. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, so today I wanted to start out a little differently. How many of you have ever taken a selfie before? Anybody ever taken a selfie? Okay, we're about to do it right now, okay? We're going to do a congregation selfie, okay? So everybody smile in the picture. You ready? 1, 2, 3. Awesome. Well, I do that because in 2003, the world changed forever. And you may be wondering what happened in 2003. Well, it was the time when the first front-facing cell phone camera came out. And suddenly it was a selfie photo became possible for the general public. So it's amazing to think about a time before that. Let me take you back to what feels like dinosaur age now, right? It was only 2003 when this came out. But before that time, before the selfie came out, you either had to, you know, take a no-look photo, right? It was turned toward you, no screen to look at. You took a no-look photo and hope you get you and what you want in the photo. Remember that? Or you had to awkwardly go up to somebody and you say, hey, could you please take my picture? Well, when every summer my family goes on a beach vacation, and because I'm the oldest of five kids, We have like 20 people that end up being there about the same time. And so what we do is, like many of you, we go down on the beach and we take a family photo. But think about this, 20 people, right? It's a lot of people on the beach. And this is kind of, the women get involved in this in a big way. They make us all dress the same, right? We all are in these matching uniform clothes, and we just kind of know that this is a way to love our spouses, right? And to love them well. So we put up with it, and we go down to the beach, and we look so silly, right? We go down to the beach, we're all wearing these matching shirts, and all of a sudden we start to find somebody, right? We start to find somebody who's going to take our family photo, right? We're looking for somebody who looks capable of running a camera, right? And at that time, before dinner, it's kind of it's slim picking. But we're looking to interrupt somebody's beach walk to get this, you know, this one person to elect them, this stranger, as our unpaid photographer. And we stand there with all of our kids trying to get everybody to smile as this person's like, would you hurry up already so I can take the picture? Aren't you glad that a selfie came out, right? A selfie is a great invention because all you have to focus on and all you need is you, right? All you need is you. In fact, all you have to do is hold your camera and you point it and focus on you. And right there in the frame, you can see how you look, right? I tell you that today we are wrapping up our series, week 4, wrapping up our series called Messy. Loving others isn't easy. What does that have to do with a selfie? Well, here's what I've learned. What I've seen when it comes to relationships is that we all have a tendency to kind of have a selfie mentality when it comes to our relationships. We tend to have a selfie mentality. What in the world is that about? It means instead of thinking about others, we tend to kind of in our lives, we think about self, right? We kind of live this like me first life, right? This me first life. With that, in most relationships, we tend to think, you know, is this relationship good for me? Right? Me first. In our business world, right? In our business relationships, we like to look at the relationships that we have and say, man, can this person advance me in my career? Can they help me to get this sale that I need? And so we think, me first. Think about when you're driving around in traffic. When you're driving around in traffic, are you usually looking around and saying, man, I hope all these other people in the morning, or I hope everybody gets here on time where they need to be? Or are you kind of, you know, you kind of looking around and you know, sometimes it's like, are we letting people in front of us? No. I've seen how you drive. It's me first, right? You're not getting in front of me, right? So a selfie mentality is really a me first life. It's a me-first life where my needs go above everything else. It's a me-first life. But as Jesus showed us, we've been looking at this passage where Jesus gave us a different model and a different way of living in John chapter 13. John chapter 13, starting with verse 34. Here's what Jesus said. Jesus said, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Now, this is pushing away from a me-first life, isn't it? Love one another, right? When you love people like Jesus loved, what happens is, man, your life gets way more fulfilled, right? In a world that says, look, I got to watch out for me, and we put up walls and we protect ourselves, Jesus taught us, no, the opposite is the key in relationships. In fact, one of the passages Jesus shared in Matthew chapter 16 talks about this, pushing away from a selfie mentality and a me-first life. Matthew 16, here's what Jesus said in verse 24. Then Jesus said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, right? In other words, push away from a selfie-centered life. Deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Right? Does that sound exciting? Right? This is not one of those bestseller books. So he says, "Well, life is all about you." Right? No, Jesus is saying, "No. If you want to find life, you got to deny yourself. It's like taking up your cross and following after Him." In other words, don't make your life just about you, because it'll be miserable and you will miss God's best. In order to have abundant life, Jesus says, "I want you to do the opposite. Deny yourself." In some ways, it means almost crucifying or dying to selfie so that you can really live. It seems kind of funny. You know, it's interesting. It's not about thinking less of yourself, though. It's about thinking of yourself less, right? Thinking of yourself less often. So the order matters. And so today, instead of a me first life, I want to invite you to live a me third life. And a me third lifestyle is really what Jesus made you for. And a me third model of relationships is really the Jesus model. It's where a me third, God first, other second, me third, right? God first, other second, me third. What would your relationships look like? What would your marriage look like? What would your relationship with your family look like if you lived this? What about your coworkers and your neighbors? What would your life look like? How would your relationships be better if you lived this? God first, other second, me third. It's not saying one is better than the other. It's saying it's an order of a mindset priority, right? And so just like Jesus died on the cross, it's basically we sometimes have to crucify our desire to want to be first. We crucify our desire, and when we do, when we live for God and for others, that's when we're most blessed. You know, Rick Warren wrote a famous book called The Purpose-Driven Life. How many of you ever read that before? Awesome, awesome book. And in that book, there's a new version. It's the same thing, basically, called What on Earth Am I Here For? And basically, in the opening line of the book, he sold millions of copies. It was a bestseller, and he opened with the craziest line, speaking into a me-first culture. And here's what he said, it's not about you. Here's the quote from Rick Warren. He said, it's not about you, in other words, life. The purpose of your life is far greater than your own personal fulfillment, your peace of mind, or even your happiness. It's far greater than your family, your career, or even your wildest dreams and ambitions. If you want to know why you were placed on this planet, you must begin with God. You were born by His purpose and for His purpose. And you know, when you think about it, that's why so many times in our relationships can get messy because we tend to get this backwards. We get it backwards in our relationship with God where we start to say, God, you know what? I care about you, but I'm me first. In our marriage relationships, so many times we can look at our spouse and say, honey, I love you, but me first, right? And this is when we get it backwards, all of a sudden we can make our relationships with God and with others kind of a mess. Because what happens is we start to see people as a means to accomplish our end, right? What we want from a relationship. But to love people like Jesus means putting God and others before ourselves. And when you do that in your relationships, man, you will find connection and value, and man, you will find purpose in all those relationships. And so let me show you in the Bible why a me third lifestyle is so much better than a selfie-centered life. Me third, right? And we're going to look at a passage the Apostle Paul wrote in his letter to the Philippians, where he showed really this Jesus upside-down way of living when it comes to relationships. And it's found in Philippians chapter 2, starting with verse 3. And it says this. This is Paul writing, and he tells you one of the hardest things ever to open the gate. He says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. In other words, don't do anything, right? Don't do anything out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves. It says, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interest of others. So what is Paul saying? Let's just stop here. We're going to get into the model in a minute. What's he saying here? He's saying, push away from a selfie-centered life. Let's live this model of me third. God first, others second, me third. Don't do anything out of selfish ambition. In other words, in a world that says, man, I'm gonna look to my needs before I look to you, it's basically look to the interest of God and people before you look to yourself. Why? This is really interesting if you think about it. If you live for only you, if you live for only you, eventually you'll have only you around you. If you live for only you, eventually you will have only you around you. Man, that's so true. And so here's the bottom line today. The bottom line for us today is this, is I want to encourage you to live beyond a selfie-centered life and your relationships will come alive. Live beyond a selfie-centered life and your relationships will come alive. Because we all tend to struggle in our relationships when we get it backwards, right? We look at my own needs and we neglect others. We think about what I want and we forget maybe what people around us need and what they want. Because so many of us, we have believed the lie that says, man, if I'm not watching out for me, right, if I look for God and others and put them first, then who's going to watch out for me? And Jesus is like, hello, right? You know, Jesus tells the story about the birds of the air and the lilies of the field, and how so many times we're so worried about, like, I got to make sure that I'm holding myself up and I'm providing for things. And Jesus is like, look, you worry about so many things, but don't you see how the lilies of the field, and I've clothed them with all the splendor? No, look at the birds of the air. Aren't you more valuable than the birds, and yet I feed them? Man, you're so worried about me, me, me. And if you will just focus on Jesus, and you'll put your needs, or your eyes toward others, Jesus is saying, I have the power to provide for you and to care for you and to help you, right? So live beyond a selfie-centered life, and your relationships, they'll come alive. Now, what Paul is not saying is, he's not condemning looking after yourself. He's not saying anything bad about self-care, right? What he's saying is, naturally, I know that you're going to think about you, right? Naturally, I know you're going to worry about your own things, but I want to encourage you instead. I want to encourage you to focus on God and focus on others, and I'll take care of you, right? So then Paul, he's going to show us this model, this upside-down model of Jesus. And this is the model Jesus has for our relationships. And let's continue reading. It's verse 5. Here's what he says next. He says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing, right? That's deny himself, right? He made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. And it says, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So this is just such an interesting model of Jesus, right? In fact, I wanted to draw it out for you, right? This is my best whiteboard attempt. But this is basically the model of Jesus, isn't it? He's a very nature God. He humbled himself, even obedient to death on a cross, and therefore God raised him up, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and tongue confess. This is the model of Jesus. And you notice the shape is the V, right? So when you look at people and you say, hey, peace, right? This could be like a symbol that we have as Christians to basically say, not just peace, but hey, let's live this lifestyle. Let's live this lifestyle. The problem is so many of us, we live in a world where everybody tries to live their life like this. You think about that? Everybody tends to live their life with this upside down V. We try to make much of ourselves. We try to become greater, right? We try to elevate ourselves above the needs of others, and we live this me first life, right? Where our relationships, you know, it tends to be where they're unfulfilled. And if you think about it, the pathway of Adam is the way most people live. Most people live like this. Right? Think about Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, right? They were the created things. They were at the bottom. God is at the top. And what did Adam and Eve do? When it comes to in the Garden of Gethsemane, they wanted to be on the same level as God. Did God really say what he meant? And they're like, you know what? I think I want to gain equality with God. I want to climb the ladder, and I want to be my own authority. And that self-reliance and that pride of trying to gain equality with God and raise themselves up, we know what happens in Genesis chapter 3, that all of a sudden everything fell because they got the order backwards. They missed the mark. But Jesus gives us a different model, doesn't he? Jesus showed us that this is the model of how I want you to live. I want you to live the V. Now think about this. Jesus is fully God. He's fully God. He is the name above all names. He's worthy of all power and praise. He sits on the highest throne, and yet Jesus, what did he do? He humbled himself. He humbled himself, right? He decided to leave his throne in heaven and to step down into our broken world so that he could look at you and me face to face and to love us right where we are. And in the middle of that, Jesus came to serve, not to be served. He came humbly to give his life for the sake of us. And so Jesus, he had all the power. He had all the power of all the cosmos was within him, but he didn't use his power to his own advantage, if you think about that. He didn't use it for his own advantage. He used it to look after you and to think about you when he died on the cross. And because of that, not only did God raise Jesus from the grave, and now he is seated on the highest throne on the right hand of the Father, but now through this pathway of Jesus, because he lowered himself, because he died a perfect, sinless death on the cross, now anyone who follows after Jesus, anyone who surrenders their life to the lordship of Jesus and follows this V, all of a sudden, God raises us up with Christ when we die, right? This is the coolest thing. This is the greatest news ever. And I want you to think about this. If this is the pathway of Jesus in his relationships, what does that mean for our relationships? I think it means that as Jesus demonstrated that, you know, if you want to love somebody, instead of making much of yourself, you got to be willing to humble yourself and to come down. Sometimes to come down to their level. Because what I've learned when it comes to leadership is so many times we like to lead from on high, right? When all of a sudden we're in a position of authority, we're a mom or a dad, right? And we like to lead from on high. But Jesus said, no, you don't influence people like that. If you want to make an impact in people, you got to be willing to humble yourself. And what happens when you do is people see Jesus living in your life and God raises so much up. All of a sudden your relationship can go to new heights. And so here's the first big truth for today. Number one, I want to encourage you, don't live the path of Adam, where life is all about elevating you. Live the path of Jesus, where you live for God and for others. Let me say it again. Don't live the path of Adam. Remember this? This is the path of Adam. Don't live the path of Adam, where life is all about elevating you. In other words, live the path of Jesus, where you live for God and you live for others. You know, when I was in college, I remember, every year in college, you have to work so hard and you wait on those breaks. You can't wait for the next break. And I remember we were thinking about spring break, and I was already thinking about what I was going to do, right? I was thinking about, man, I'm going to probably go to the beach. I'm going to just finally relax. I've been working so hard. I can't wait to do that. And instead of going to spring break, though, I was talked into going on a mission trip. To New York City. Can I be honest? I was talked into that, right? And very reluctantly, right, I said yes, because it was a bunch of friends from the Wesley Foundation. And my first response when they were asking me, hey, don't you want to go on this trip? It's going to be awesome. I remember thinking, man, I think I'd rather be at the beach, right? I think I'd rather, like, just kick up my feet and stop working for a minute, right? Because I've been working hard in school. You guys maybe remember those days. It was one of those things where I just said yes because I felt like, you know what? Okay, God, I think you want me to go on this. And it was a really interesting mission trip. We went to New York City and we saw some cool sights. I remember there was this one time where we actually, for some reason, we walked with a homeless man who said, do you want to see the best view in all of New York City? And we're like, yeah. And we followed him down a dark alley. I don't know why we did it. And we walked for a while, and we got to the edge of the Brooklyn Bridge, and we walked almost to the very top of the Brooklyn Bridge. And he said, this is the best view. People will pay so much money to stay in these awesome hotels, but this is the best view in all of New York City. It was awesome. But it was also a weird trip because it took some sacrificing. We stayed at this church. It was an old church, and we were supposed to stay on the floor, right? We were supposed to basically sleep on the floor. And we did, but we looked around, and even during the day, you could see rats and mice going everywhere, right? And so that was like, oh, Lord, I think I should be at the beach, right? It was this conflicting thing, like, Lord, am I supposed to do this? And I'm doing it for you, and hopefully this sacrifice is a praise to you as these rats are on the floor, right? But on this mission trip, we got to serve alongside of a bunch of homeless people. We served in a soup kitchen. And we cooked food and we served these homeless men who came to the shelter. And the guy who was the cook at that shelter, his name was Hot Sauce. I have no idea what his name really was, right? But everybody called, he wouldn't tell us, hey, what's your real name? He said, Hot Sauce. And everybody called him Hot Sauce because he liked to spice it up in everything that he cooked, right? And so anyway, it was really, really interesting. What that trip did on my heart was something pretty transformative, right? Because as I started to serve people who had so little, what happened is I stopped thinking about myself and all the things that I was missing as a college student, right, by going to the beach on spring break. And I thought, you know, this is the life that I think we were made for as I was serving these homeless guys in New York City. And at the same time, I had this really strange feeling. Not only did it make me feel good, but it was like Jesus, it felt like Jesus was just so present. It was like as we were serving, and I sat down at the table and talked to these homeless men who had these amazing stories of God's faithfulness. As I looked into their eyes, it was like I was looking into the eyes of Jesus. It's interesting, Jesus tells a story about that. Jesus tells an interesting story about what happens when we humble ourselves and we're willing to serve the least. And we're going to look at just part of the story today. I encourage you to read the rest of it later because he talks about two groups of people. One group of people who are the sheep who belong to Jesus and the other group of people who are the goats, right? And not greatest of all time, right? These are the people who basically are not followers of Jesus. And so read that later. But we're going to jump into the very first part of the story, Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25, starting with verse 34. This is Jesus speaking, okay? He says, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me.'" Jesus is saying this. "I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" Then the king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me." Whatever you did to the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. This is Jesus sharing this to us. And suddenly I started to realize why it felt like that on that mission trip. See, when you serve people, it's one of the best ways you can serve Jesus. When you serve people, it's like you're serving Jesus. Instead of having a Muhammad Ali kind of mindset where it's like we're always thinking, man, I am the greatest, right? And we get on social media and our profile is just about us. I'm the greatest. Jesus is like, look, you will be most blessed if you humble yourself and you serve the least. You know, the disciples were asking Jesus, but Jesus like, okay, when do we see you hungry and thirsty? When do we see you a stranger or in need of, you know, clothing? Jesus, when do we see you sick or, you know, in prison, right? When do we see you like that? The assumption is, Jesus, we see needs all around us, right? I mean, there's so many times where people are wanting us to stop and help and things like that. But Jesus, if it was you, like, we would have helped you. We would have served you. We would have honored you. We would have done anything to welcome you in. And Jesus turns it on us. And he basically is saying the relationship that you have with Jesus is the relationship that he wants us to have with every person around us. He says, look, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, it's like you're doing it for me. See, Jesus, when he says the least of these, he's not diminishing people. He's not saying that, hey, some people are ranked higher than others, right? And it's not based on how much income you have. It doesn't mean that like, if you're more self-sufficient than others, then you're higher and some are the least and lower. But he's basically talking about the least of these are those who are more vulnerable, those who are more in need around us. And in a strange way, when we serve the least, it's like we're doing it for Jesus himself. I got to tell you, when I was serving on this mission trip, it was messy at times. There was this one moment we were serving in the soup kitchen, everything was going good, And I start walking down this kind of dark alley again. I guess that's what happens in New York City. And I'm walking with a group of people, and this guy was like, hey, can I get something to eat? And I was like, oh, Lord, we've been doing this all day, right? We've been doing this all day. And I was like, oh, can we just have some me time for a minute, right? And I was like, okay, what do you need? He's like, I just need something to eat. And I was like, all right, well, come in here. I'll get you some pizza. And there was a pizza restaurant right there. I'm like, thank you, Lord, for providing an opportunity for me to serve, right? And so I showed up, and we went into this thing, and I paid for him to get, like, a couple slices of pizza. And he grabs my hand, and I was like, oh, no, right? He grabs my hand, and he puts it on his head. And I was, like, you know, freaked out for a minute, right? And he looked at me, and he said, that is where they put the metal plate. When I had that injury and what put me on the street, that's why I'm where I am. Thank you so much for serving me today. And suddenly I realized that, man, what God had, it was a divine appointment. God showed me that, man, there are people who have needs all around us, and we have no idea why people are in the position that they're in, the stories that they have. But in the middle of that, they've seen God's faithfulness, and we get to be a part of that story. And so it may be difficult and messy at times. It can cost us something, right, when we serve the least. But it's one of those things, when we serve the strangers and the lost and the least, God is somehow a part of it. And I realized there in New York City, as I served these homeless men, that if it felt like I was looking into the eyes of Jesus, because maybe I was. There's so many stories in the Bible where God visits people through the lens of a stranger, right? And I realized that on this trip, maybe those people did need me to come and serve them, but maybe, just maybe, I needed them more than they needed me. Because on that mission trip, as I started to serve those guys, it opened up Jesus' heart for people. On that mission trip, what I realized is, as I served these guys, it pushed me away from a me-centered life and a me-centered purpose. See, this passage calls us to humble ourselves to the needs of those around you. And so let me just ask you this. Who might represent the least of these in our community around us? Who are those people that might represent the least of these? Think about that. Maybe there's people who are in need in ways when it comes to food and economic ways. But there are people who maybe are the least of these when it comes to the strangers. People who walk into worship at a church, and man, they're so worried about, oh, am I going to be accepted? Am I going to belong? And we get to be the church to say, hey, you're welcome here. We're so glad that you're here. Who are the least of these in our community? Here's the second last truth for you today. Number two is, I want to encourage you that serving people is the greatest way to overcome a selfie-centered life. Serving people is the greatest way to overcome a selfie-centered life. I know that because that's what Jesus did for me. The more you start to serve people, the more we start to pick and fuss about the little things that annoy us, and we start to say, wow, God, you have so much purpose for me. Serving is the greatest tool that pushes away this pathway of Adam that says, man, life is all about me and making myself great. And it moves us to the pathway of Jesus, where we humble ourselves so that we can experience what God wants to do through the lives of others. Let's pray together as we continue this time. God, we thank you so much. We thank you so much that you are good and that you love us. God, we thank you that as we think about this me-centered life that so many of us end up living, that God, you call us to live beyond a selfie-centered life so that our relationships can experience life. God, as we worship you and as we continue to live our lives, we pray that you would help us to think me-third. This me-third principle, where we give ourselves away for the sake of you, God, and for the sake of others. God, we just pray that this is not something that we can do in and of ourselves. We need the Spirit of the living God to empower us. And so, Jesus, as we worship you, we pray that you would help us, God. We pray that you would help us in all that we do to push away from this selfie-centered life, to live for more than us, to live for you, and to live for the sake of others, for the sake of the world around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Why don't we stand up as we sing that today?
I'm laying down my life, giving up control, never looking back. this passion in my heart, stirring in my soul. See the nations bow for all the world to know. Living for your glory on the earth. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire in me. Light a flame in my soul, for every eye to see. For the sake of the world, burn like a fire. Passion in my heart, stirring in my soul. See the nations bow for all the world to know. I'm living for your glory on the earth. Oh, for the sake of the world, burn like a fire.
Yeah.
never stop believing, 'cause he's so, so good. So, so good.